Let's open our Bibles tonight to the Gospel of John in the New Testament, John 13, Lessons on Love. Jesus is going to institute the Last Supper in the regular Passover meal, and he's going to talk about love. He's going to teach about love. We're going to see, first of all, that love involves serving, as Jesus serves by washing the disciples' feet. We're going to see a lack of love as Judas betrays the Lord Jesus. We're going to see the commandment of love, that we are to love one another. And then we're going to see a lapse of love on the part of Peter as he denies the Lord. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, in the words of Jesus in tonight's study. Or as the Beatles put it in their song, all you need is love, right? Let's bow our hearts before the Lord. Father, we're grateful for this chance to study your word. Help us to understand and allow love to flow through our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Love. It's now the last night the Lord's going to be here on earth. It's Thursday night. They're having the regular Passover meal. And at the end of that meal, the Lord's going to take two elements, and he's going to commemorate something entirely different, taking the bread, representing his body, taking the cup, representing the blood. And we read about that in Matthew and Mark and Luke. John does not talk about the elements. Instead, he talks about an expression of love or servanthood, the washing of feet. John chapter 13, let's begin with verse 1. Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Already we see our theme of love, and we see that he's about to go to the Father. We see that Jesus loved his own who were in the world, those who belonged to him, who came to him, and he loved them to the end. That's real love. Not just for a while, not just for a season, not just when it feels good or it's expedient, but love to the end. And supper being ended, the devil having already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper and laid aside his garments, took a towel, and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. Then he came to Simon Peter. And Peter said to him, Lord, are you washing my feet? Jesus answered and said to him, what I am doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this. Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Jesus said to him, he who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, but not all of you. For he knew who would betray him, therefore he said, you are not all clean. Well, we'll stop there for a moment and just pick up on what's happening here. We see the washing of the feet of the disciples, and we see this tension, if you will, this contrast between love and the lack of love, the love of Jesus for his own, a love that he has until the end. And then we see the lack of love of Judas, who is going to betray him. And as the Lord is in the Last Supper, John does not talk about the elements, the bread and the cup. He's talking about this foot washing, which has become a ceremony in some churches throughout the centuries, even until this day, a commemoration of the servanthood of the Lord Jesus. And even today, there are churches that will get into the foot washing as an expression of that. Most churches, I think, or many churches don't do a literal foot washing, but take more the symbolism behind it. That is the idea of serving one another. So foot washing can be really meeting someone's need. Somebody who's got an operation on the leg and can't mow the lawn, a neighbor comes in and mows that lawn. That's foot washing in that expression. Can't have some food, so a neighbor brings a casserole. That, in a sense, is foot washing as well. Whatever the need is, when someone fills it, in a sense, that's washing of feet or being a servant. So here he rises from the supper table, right in the middle of this Passover meal, or perhaps at the end, takes a towel, puts it around his waist, and pours water into a basin, and he no doubt gets on his hands and feet. Now his disciples know that he is the Lord. They know he's from heaven, they know he is God in the flesh, and they're watching him get on his feet, on his knees, before them to wash their feet. Now, that was a job for a servant, and in some areas, the servant wasn't even required to do it in his master's household. But when the need arose and the servant was there to wash the feet, that's what the servant did. And that's what Jesus is doing here, taking the role of a servant. And that's the theme of this section here, being a servant. And so he is washing their feet, he's wiping them, and naturally Peter's going to have something to say, isn't he? We expect that from Peter. And Peter's a little embarrassed, no doubt, taken back that the Lord is taking this low road. None of the disciples chose to wash each other's feet. Remember now in those days they would walk around the dusty roads with sandals, and so the feet would get dusty. And it was common to wash the hands and wash the feet before dinner. Nobody did it. So Peter is, in a sense, objecting, and he's saying, Lord, are you washing my feet? I think he's very, very surprised and perhaps a bit embarrassed. And Jesus says in verse 7, what I am doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this. What does that mean? You do not know or understand now. You will later on. Well, certainly in the natural, we're seeing him washing feet. But there's a greater significance behind it. And I think the significance is you're going to meet the need of others. You're going to be a servant. If you want to be great in God's kingdom, he says, learn to be the servant of all. And that's what the Lord is doing. He is being the servant of all on this occasion. Well, Peter now is objecting, you shall never wash my feet. In other words, I'm not worthy that you should do this. You are too high and mighty to do that for me. But Jesus said, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. If I don't wash you, what does that mean? Not talking about the foot washing now, but he's talking about cleansing. I have come to offer you cleansing. That's my mission in life, to cleanse. And he's talking really about his sacrifice, talking about his death, the shedding of his blood. Because Hebrews tells us without the shedding of blood, there's no remission, no forgiveness of sin. And so Jesus becomes the one who cleanses us through the shedding of his own blood. The water becomes a picture of that here, but it's his cleansing, and that's what I need to do. And if I can't wash you, if I can't wash away your sins, then you have no part with me. And that speaks to me of family and friends. I have members of my family who do not love the Lord Jesus, do not know him, do not acknowledge him in any way. And so they're not allowing him to wash them. And if he doesn't wash them, then they have no part with him and he has no part with them. There's no relationship there. So the washing refers to the blood being shed. Paul later on talks about the washing of the water of the word as the word cleanses us. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word. The word cleanses us and brings us to Christ to receive that cleansing of his blood. Well, after Peter objected, you're never going to wash my feet, the Lord says, if I don't wash you, if I don't cleanse you, you have no part with me. Then Peter wants to jump right in. Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Peter, as they all do so many times, is thinking about the natural level. All right, so if I need to be cleansed by you, let's not stop with the feet, let's do the head, let's do the hands, let's do the whole thing. And you have to love his exuberance, but he's talking about the natural. So all right, so let's go ahead and get my hands clean, and get my hair spruced up, the Lord's talking about the spiritual significance of cleansing. And he says, he who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, but not all of you. It's a little hard to understand, isn't it? He who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. So we're talking on two levels here. We're talking on the level of the physical washing, the washing of the feet. Talking on the spiritual level, the cleansing from sin. And the Lord is indicating here that if you have come to me and received cleansing for your sins by making me your sin bearer, your Savior, then all you need to do is to have your feet washed or to have the immediate need met. What does that mean? I'd been saved about a year, and I called my pastor one day and I said, Pastor, I have a question. I said, I gave my heart to Jesus about a year ago, and I know that he forgave me of my sins and I was cleansed. But I have sinned since then. I sin every day. So if I gave my heart to the Lord a year ago, and that took care of all of my sins in the past, what about the sins that I have been committing since then and the sin that I commit today? And he gave me the wonderful scripture from John, the very John who wrote this gospel. In his little epistle, his first epistle, 1 John 1:9, John says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So I began to realize then that when I came to the Lord, he forgave all of my sins, gave me new life, eternal life. But as a sinner, I still need to come to him and realize that that blood still cleanses me from my sins now. And so when the Lord's talking about the fact that he has cleansed us, he says, he who is bathed, in other words, you came to me and gave your life to me, and I cleansed you from your sin, you only need to wash your feet. In other words, confess the sins that you have done today, and you're completely clean. You don't need to ask for salvation again. That's a mistake that little church that I went to taught, that you could lose your salvation. And so every Sunday night, we'd have the altar call. We'd come up there and give our hearts to the Lord all over again. That's like being completely clean again. That's like taking a bath every hour and every minute. No, once you give your heart to Christ, he cleanses you from all sin, gives you new life. You have salvation. You're not going to lose it. But when you sin, you still need to ask for forgiveness, and that same blood that brought you into the born-again experience continues to cleanse. And John, in that little epistle, uses the present tense. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us the sins and to cleanse us in the present continuous tense. That blood cleanses. So, in the natural, you and I could use this illustration. You took a shower or a bath today, and you're clean, but you handled stuff and you need to wash your hands. Your mother told you that, wash your hands before you sit down to eat. You didn't have to take a bath again before you ate, just wash your hands. Same with the salvation experience. Once you come to Christ, he cleanses you from all sin, but a minute later you sin, you ask for his forgiveness and he cleanses you from that sin. There's been a false doctrine going around that once you give your heart to Christ and he cleanses you from all sin, you should never ask forgiveness in the future for sin because his blood continues to cleanse. That's not true. You're not going to lose your salvation, but after you've given your heart to Christ, you still need to ask forgiveness because there are consequences for sin. And if you don't ask forgiveness, you're not going to be forgiven for that sin. What's going to happen is if we come to Christ today and live 30 more years from now and never ask forgiveness for any of the sins for those 30 years, we're going to go to heaven. We're going to go to the judgment seat of Christ. We're going to be cleansed for all those sins that were done in our past. But the Lord's going to bring out a 30-year list of all the unconfessed sins, and we're going to lose rewards right and left, and it's going to be one embarrassing situation. And so it's kind of like in a family relationship. Did you ever get mad at your parents? or your kids or someone else? What time is it, right? How long ago did we do that? And you ask forgiveness. I'm sorry for anything I've ever done wrong. And you're forgiven. And the slate is clean. But tomorrow you do something against your relative again and you've got a problem. And you say, well, I already asked forgiveness yesterday for anything that I've done or could do. I'm not going to ask forgiveness again. What's going to happen? And the day after, you sin again, and you've got another problem with that person. Down the road, 2 weeks later, you got 15 things that they're unhappy about with you. And you find the relationship being still there because it's still your mother or your son or what have you, but the fellowship's not there. You've got a problem. What's the solution? Ask forgiveness. Keep a short account. That's what he's saying here. He's saying, I've cleansed you, but you'd still every day need to ask forgiveness for your sins because my blood will continue to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So now that illustration is there, and he talks about clean, meaning those who have been cleansed and forgiven and saved. He's looking around the table. He's got his 12 disciples there. One of them is not clean. One of them is not born again. One of them is not saved. He calls him the son of the devil, son of Belial. For he knew who would betray him. And this brings the idea of a lack of love. Jesus loves his disciples. Judas doesn't really love the Lord. He's showing that by his betrayal. And the Lord knew who would betray him. I wonder how long he knew. The Father had chosen by Jesus praying to the Father, and the Lord made the selection with the Father's approval 3 years before, 3.5 years. Do you think the Lord knew all the time that the betrayer would be Judas? We don't know for sure. It's only conjecture. But I suspect he did. All that time, he knew he'd betray him. And yet he still walked with him and loved him and cared for him. But he's now going to call him out. You are not all clean. Verse 12. So when he had washed their feet, taken his garments, and sat down, he said to them, do you know what I have done to you? There's a deeper significance here. He's trying to get them to think beyond the superficial level of washing feet. And again, I think the message here is servanthood. Grab a towel. Do what you can to meet the need. Do you know what I've done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. Teacher and Lord. Teacher, the one who shows us the truth. Lord, the master of our lives. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. So what am I doing by washing your feet? I'm your teacher, and I'm your Lord or your master. As your teacher, I'm giving you an example. As your Lord, I'm saying if I do it, then you as sure as shooting ought to do it as well. So verse 14, if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, here it is, you also ought to wash one another's feet. Then the question comes, is he talking just about a literal foot washing, or is the foot washing an example, really, of meeting a need of another, whatever it might be? And he gives you the answer in the very next verse. For I have given you an example. Now, if the person needs to have the feet washed, then wash the feet. But in most cases, the person's not going to need that, but is going to need something else. And I'm giving this to you as an example. It's an example that you should do as I have done. Why? And here's where the lordship comes in. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. If I've done this, in other words, you ought to do it, because my whole life down here has been an example to you of what you're supposed to do. If you know these things, blessed or happy are you if you do them. We all have illustrations in our lives about servanthood. My mother and I had a typical mother and son relationship, loved each other, but rather fire and ice, very typical of many relationships, and times of working together, times of not even talking. And we both became born again a year apart, and the Lord brought us together in ministry, but we still had our natural qualities and disagreements. We were very much alike. And there came a time in my life that I dreaded. It was time for me to truly be a servant, as mother and dad were not really able to function properly in a nursing home, and it became evident that we had to buy a home in the Albany area, and I would have to convert that into a nursing home experience where they could be at home and have personal care by me and a couple of attendants. It was difficult. In fact, the real estate broker reminded me that the night that I signed the contract, for the home, I cried. A grown man in his early 60s crying. Not for the joy of having his own home. I left my own bachelor pad out in another town, and I cried because I knew what was ahead. It was a rainy, stormy night, and my heart was reflecting that rainy, stormy condition. And I was so, so unhappy. I knew a little bit about what was ahead, but I had no idea what it would be like as the next 7 years would unfold, and taking care of Dad, and then he passed, and Mother, and then she passed, and all the needs. And every night for 7 years, I was their only attendant. They wanted nobody else and really didn't need anybody else. We had qualified nurses in the church who would have loved to come on in and offered to come on in and help. But from 4 p.m. until 8 a.m, every day for 7 years, I was the only attendant. Learned to sleep in my jogging outfit. Didn't go into under the covers for 7 years because it was constant trips to the hospital in the middle of the night. Police coming in, ambulance, whatever. And I cried out to God, and I wanted to die, and I just couldn't stand my life. And I was still pastoring, never missed a day at church, still came in during the day and pastored. And I said, Lord, how can I do this? And the Lord gave me that scripture. If you want to be great in my kingdom, learn to be the servant of all. Dad was easy. He and I were best friends. Mother and I, not so easy, not best friends. After Dad passed, it was just Mother and me, and I really had to hone down and say, Lord, how do I do this? And he said, it's really rather simple. In the past, you two have sparred and argued because you were trying to get your way, like a lot of kids trying to get their own way. He said, you're here to be a servant. You just do whatever you need to do to meet her needs. And if she wants to take her medication, she takes her medication. If she doesn't, she doesn't. She wants to go to the doctors, she goes. Wants to go to the hospital, she goes. If she doesn't, she doesn't. It's her life. You just serve. And so that began a very tough experience. But once I got the hang of it, that I'm simply here not to be right, not to have my argument won, not to have my way accomplished, but simply to meet that need, it became easy. And as that happened, the joy of the Lord began to come into my heart. The ministry began to reflect the sense of servanthood. And the funny thing was, there never needed to be a call to a nurse to come on in, except one night, which I didn't know to be the last night. And about 9 o'clock at night, Mother began to fuss a little bit. And I got over and put my nose next to her nose, and I was teasing her and saying, you're a lousy roommate. I'm trying to get a little rest here at the foot of your bed, and you're fussing. She looked at me and said, shoot me. And I said, love you, babe. I'll be taking a little nap. I'll see you shortly. I was about to call the nurse, and the Lord said, no. Just go downstairs and rest. So I went down to take my typical 10-minute nap. 2 hours later, I woke up panicked because I never slept that long. And went upstairs, and when I walked into the door before I saw her, I knew she'd passed. But that was my lesson on servanthood, and I've been having other lessons as well, and I realize you've got your stories. And when life is tough, and life is tough, the only way to get through it is to be a servant. There's an old expression about how to be successful in business. Find a need and fill it. That's it. Find a need and fill it. We spend too much time trying to dream of our own concepts of how to do things. Just look around you and see what the need is and then fill it. And that's where the happiness is going to come. Oh, to be a pastor, to be in the pulpit, to get behind the microphone, to be on television. Oh, and this is wonderful. Well, God is good, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to share. But these hands also have been in toilets cleaning, as have yours. These hands have had to do menial tasks and things I'd rather not have to do. That's life. We all have to be servants. Find a need to fill it. Being in the pulpit on television is a need. Unplugging the toilet when it needs to be unplugged is also a need. And you have your own experiences as well. And incidentally, what's more important to God? Being on television proclaiming the gospel or unplugging the clogged toilet? I don't know that I have an answer for that. I suspect in God's mind it's all the same. Whatever needs to be done, you do it. So that's the idea of servanthood. That's real love. I don't love my wife. I don't love my kids. I don't love my this or that. Then, Lord, help me to be a servant. Find a way to serve. And as you find a way to serve, where your treasure is, there your heart is also. Your treasure is your time, your work, your resources. You start to invest yourself in someone else. Where your treasure is, your heart's going to be there as well. Jesus said, you pray for your enemy, for those who despitefully use you, somebody that you can't stand. Begin to pray for that person. Take that person to lunch. Stop at Taco Bell or McDonald's or what have you and pick up something for them. Just pray for them. The next thing you know, you care about them. Next thing you know, you love them. You're serving them. And then don't be surprised that what goes out comes back. Sowing and reaping. All right, now we're going to see in verse 18 this lack of love by Judas, as the Lord identifies the scripture that foretells this, and then he identifies the culprit, Judas himself. You see, everything that's going on in the Lord's life, especially in these last moments, was all foretold in the Old Testament. There are over 300 prophecies in the Old Testament about the Messiah, especially concentrating on these last moments of his life and his death and his resurrection. Verse 18 of John chapter 13. I do not speak concerning all of you. In other words, not all the disciples. I know whom I have chosen, but that the scripture may be fulfilled. He who eats bread with me has lifted up his heel against me. So I'm not talking about all of you betraying me, but only one of you. And your betrayal has already been foretold in Scripture, and here he's quoting from the Old Testament, Psalm 41, is it? You'll see that as your reference. He who eats bread with me has lifted up his heel against me. Somebody who was close to me, broke bread with me daily. Now, actually, who wrote that psalm? That was David, talking about a personal experience. David was a prophet, but on this occasion, he wasn't even thinking about being a prophet. He was just telling about something that happened in his own life. And so he wasn't thinking about the Messiah, I would suspect. He was just sad about the fact that his closest counselor, who ate bread with him daily, turned against him and went with David's son Absalom, as Absalom revolted against his father and tried to kill him and take over the kingdom of Israel. The $5 question is, who was that counselor who betrayed David? Ahithophel. And Ahithophel did turn, leave David, and go to Absalom to then conspire against the man whom he served before. But also he was speaking of the greater fulfillment, Judas betraying the Lord Jesus. Verse 19. Now I tell you before it comes, even before it has taken place, that when it does come to pass, you may believe that I am he. So I'm telling you ahead of time, I am going to be betrayed. And when you look back afterwards, you'll realize who I really am and that I am he, the one who was sent by God. Because I spoke of what would take place, and when it does take place, it'll confirm it. Now, most assuredly, I say to you, he who receives whomever I send receives me, and he who receives me receives him who sent me. So he's talking here about the close relationship he has with his followers. While Judas is going to betray him, the other disciples are going to represent him. And as they go out to serve the Lord, they'll be received as if they were the Lord. He who receives whomever I send receives me. And if he receives me, he receives really the Father who sent me. So when you and I go out, we're representing Jesus, representing the Father. As people are accepting what we say and giving us a warm welcome, they're welcoming the Lord or the Lord's ambassador. But if they're ridiculing us or persecuting us, really that persecution and ridicule goes against the Lord himself and ultimately against the Father. Now, when Jesus had said these things, he was troubled in spirit and testified. Now, he'd been thinking about this before, but now the time had come, and it truly troubled him. This betrayal troubled him. Betrayal always troubles us. Were you ever betrayed? Among the different kinds of betrayal, perhaps the worst kind of betrayal we have here on earth could be in the marriage bed, when a spouse turns against the other and ends in divorce, or worse, death, whatever. That may be the hardest betrayal. We've all been betrayed. I'm amazed at the number of people I talk to, and I ask about their children, and they tell me the names of their children and their ages, and then they tell me that if they have three or four kids, they have a close relationship with one or two, and they have a so-so relationship with one, and there's no communication with another. I see that and hear that all the time. That's got to have a sense of betrayal to it. Sad. We've all been betrayed. And it troubles our spirit, even as it troubles the Lord. Most assuredly, I say to you, one of you will betray me. Then the disciples looked at one another, perplexed about whom he spoke. There were only 12 of them in the immediate circle. They had lived with the Lord for 3.5 years. They knew each other intimately. They had no idea who it was. They're perplexed. Now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples whom Jesus loved. And that's a picture of John himself, and you'll see in paintings at the Last Supper, John leaning on the breast of Jesus. Simon Peter therefore motioned to him to ask who it was of whom he spoke. Then leaning back on Jesus' breast, he said to him, Lord, who is it? Jesus answered, it is he to whom I shall give a piece of bread when I have dipped it. And having dipped the bread, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. So which one of us is going to betray? So the Lord takes bread, he dips it in what? Olive oil, maybe? And maybe some gravy from the juice of the lamb, we don't know, but he dips it, gives it to Simon. Now this is interesting because there's not much going on here, just 12 men plus Jesus, and he hands the bread to somebody, and you think we should be understanding what's going on here, but it's kind of like they're fuzzy. Now, after the piece of bread, Satan entered him, that's Judas, and Jesus said to him, what you do, do quickly. All right, you're determined to betray me? Do it quickly. But no one at the table knew for what reason he said this to him. So they've seen, no doubt, the passing of the bread to Judas, but it doesn't register for some reason. They're kind of in a fog at this point, confused, maybe even in grief. They know it's the end. They know that in a matter of hours, the Lord's going to leave them. Sorrow can produce a bit of a fog in its own way as well, but they don't know really what's going on. And as another gospel writer said, they all said in their hearts, is it I? Am I going to betray you? So there's that element of honesty within their hearts that they're not going to betray him, but they're saying, I could, and will I? But only one really will. And as far as talking to Jesus, Jesus says to Judas, what you do, do quickly. They didn't connect that with the betrayal. They connected that with the fact that Judas was kind of their treasurer, the one that handled the money. Verse 29, some thought because Judas had the money box that Jesus had said to him, buy those things we need for the feast, or that he should give something to the poor. So he thought it was maybe a word to the treasurer, go out and take care of some finances. Having received the piece of bread, he then went out immediately, and it was night. So they're not sure what's going on. Jesus has known probably all along that Judas was going to betray him. Jesus also knew that Judas, as the treasurer, having the money box to buy things for the group of 12 plus others, to give to the poor, that Judas was a thief. And yet he never removed him from office, did he? Never removed him from the band of 12 so he couldn't betray him, never took him out of his office of being a treasurer, but he still worked with him. We see an example in one of his parables about the fact that not all who are in the church are really of the Lord. It's kind of like the wheat and the tares, the good wheat and the weeds. It's not our job to root them out, throw them out. That's the Lord's job in the harvest time at the end, to separate them. So yes, if we see somebody stealing, we are to take action to be sure, but we need to balance and really back off the judgment role and move more toward the salvation role. Lord, I like to judge people. I like to criticize them. I like to get rid of them. I like to put them down, remove them. Help me to become more of a servant and more of a savior in the sense of letting you work in your salvation through their lives. We need to all pray that, I think. Meanwhile, they don't really quite know what's going on about this betrayal. So verse 31 now leads a new section here. This is talking about love as a commandment. He gives the command to love, and then he talks about the effect of that love. So when he had gone out, Jesus said, now the Son, that's when Judas had left, the Lord says, now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. Notice that Judas leaves before Jesus talks about glorification. There's a connection there, I think, because Judas is not saved. He does not want the Lord glorified. He's not there to seek the Father's glory. He's there serving the devil. He needs to be removed. And once he's gone, the Lord can now take those who are open and receptive and talk about really the significance of what's about to happen. The Son of Man is now glorified. Through this act of my death, burial, and resurrection, I'll be glorified, and ultimately, God the Father will be glorified. And incidentally, for all of us who will receive Jesus as Lord and Savior, we will be glorified with his glory. If God is glorified in him, in Jesus, God will also glorify him in himself and glorify him immediately. Jesus really keeps his eye on the goal, and that's the glory of God. And God is going to then glorify Jesus, and he's going to glorify him immediately. And if I can keep my eye on the focus of glory, I'll be better off. Going back to the story of Mother and me and Dad and me and serving here, Lord, may this be for the glory of God. And I wasn't even thinking about this. I was thinking basically about getting 10 minutes of sleep if I could, or who's going to take care of this or that. But you know what I kept getting from people in the congregation and others? Wow, what an example you're setting. You're setting an example for us about how to honor our parents and how to take care of them. Thank you for your testimony. Thank you for your example. And I wasn't doing it for them. I just wanted to get through each day without killing myself and killing my parents as well. And yet it was an example, and God's glory was being manifested through this act of servanthood that I was barely able to manage by his grace. So when you and I are serving, we are loving, and we are showing the glory of God. And that's what it's all about. That's what Jesus wanted to do, glorify the Father. And so he says, little children, I shall be with you a little while longer. You will seek me, and as I said to the Jews, where I am going, you cannot come. So now I say to you, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. So he now calls them little children. These young men who are his own age, basically. But they're his children because he's their shepherd, he's their father. I'll be with you now just a matter of hours. If you seek me, where I'm going, you can't come now. So I'll be in heaven, and you're going to be here for a while on earth. But I want to give you a new commandment. This is the bottom line of what it's all about. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. These are really just about his final words to the disciples. Pay attention to somebody who's close to death. If that person is not impaired through medications or mentally, if that person is clear, pay attention to the closing words, the summary of life in just a few short sentences. They'll give you what's really important. They'll condense all of the years, all the experiences, all the wisdom into the bottom line. And here's the bottom line, that you love one another. And the effect of that is that by this, all will know that you're my disciples. If you have love for one another, because I've loved you, you love others, it shows you're mine, you're my followers. What does that mean, a new commandment? You know, that's in the Old Testament, to love one another. That was the law of Moses. They had that for 1,500 years. What does it mean, a new commandment? In fact, if you look at the Ten Commandments, the first four commandments talk about loving God. The last six commandments talk about loving fellow man. So they knew they were supposed to love one another, but I think the key may be here in verse 34, as I have loved you, love one another. Up until the love of Jesus expressed in his sacrifice, all they knew was the commandment to love your fellow neighbor. But now Jesus, by his example, was living proof of the kind of love that we need to give, a love that would go to the cross and die for us. On our part, a love that would die to self, take up our cross and follow him. So it's a new love that they never had before because it was a love expressed in and exemplified by Jesus Christ himself. And so for you and for me, I think it's best to say, don't just go out there and love other people, but let the love of Jesus Christ flow through your life. Don't just love, but say, Jesus, you love through me. My wife and I had lunch this week with old friends, missionary friends. They'd never met her before, but they had a chance to meet her. They were off the mission field in a very dangerous part of the world. And my wife said afterwards, after they'd gone, Jesus was all over them. And that said it all. She saw Jesus in their lives, the love of Jesus, and that's what it should be for us, the love of Jesus. Not just that person's a loving person, a good person, but Jesus is all over that person. Let my love flow through you. Then, verse 36, we see that there's a lapse of love. Peter loves Jesus, unlike Judas. But Peter has a lapse of love because of fear. Verse 36, Simon Peter said to Jesus, Lord, where are you going? Jesus answered him, where I am going, you cannot follow me now, but you shall follow me afterward. So Peter had a vague idea he was going to die, but he wasn't really quite sure where he was going to go when he died. And the Lord says, you can't come now, but you will come later. Peter said to him, Lord, why can I not follow you now? I will lay down my life for your sake. And I believe he's totally sincere. I think he really wants to be with the Lord Jesus. He loves him. He willingly will give his life up, he thinks. And Jesus answered him, "Will you lay down your life for my sake? Most assuredly, I say to you, the rooster shall not crow till you have denied me 3 times. So you think you love me? You think you're ready to die for me and with me? You won't even say you know me. Before the rooster crows, you'll deny me 3 times. And so we all think we love the Lord. We think we will do whatever we can to serve him, and we do love him if we give our hearts to him. But there come those times when denial seems the easier way out. We're at work, and the boss makes it pretty clear he does not like Christians, does not like Jesus people, and we just kind of slither down in our seat and put our hoods over our heads and become part of the Lord's secret service. And other examples as well. Or people at the kitchen table, family gathers together for Thanksgiving, and relatives are there, and let's not make waves. Let's not. We know that Uncle Sid and Aunt Sarah can't stand believers, and they believe we all came out of the primordial ooze, and so let's just kind of not talk about the Lord. We all have these situations. Now, it doesn't mean you get up on a soapbox and begin to advertise all the time that you love the Lord, but are you willing to say, "Here I am, Lord, use me. These are your lips, your heart, your mind. I'll speak out if you tell me." And we need to be able to not deny the Lord. Well, that's denying the Lord with our lips when we're quiet. What about our lives? I love Jesus, and I'm in church, and I'm on the front row, and I'm on television, and I'm in this and that. But don't follow me home, and don't get into my mind, and don't see where I go and the things that I do. And so what about our lives? Do our lives deny the truth of our walk with the Lord? I love you, Lord, but my lifestyle doesn't indicate it. There's an old saying when somebody says, "Please don't open your mouth because who you are screams so loudly, I can't hear what you're saying." And so we need to love the Lord and confess him, not only with our mouths, but also with our lives. So it's love. And as the Beatles sang, "All you need is love." I'm not sure what kind of love they were talking about, but the love the Lord's talking about is a love of service. And I want to close with the greatest expression of the definition of love, I think, we have. We use it in our wedding ceremonies, and it's from 1 Corinthians 13. And it's not all about, oh, the curve of your thigh or the flow of your gown or the flush on your face or the Hollywood beating of my heart. That's not the love he's talking about. That can be passion, that can be lust and what have you, but this love is all about servanthood. 1 Corinthians 13, here's the classic definition of love. Verse 4, love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself, is not puffed up, does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not provoked, thinks no evil or keeps no account of evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. Servanthood. Let's pray. Father, we're grateful for the chance to have studied your word tonight. Help us to realize that we don't even have to ask you for love, because when you come into our hearts, Paul tells the Roman church, you shed throughout our hearts the love of God. As we receive Jesus, we receive an inexhaustible reservoir of love. So the love's already there. But what blocks the flow of that love? Sin, self, Satan. Lord, help us not to block the flow of love, but to deal with our sins, to confess our sins, and to receive your forgiveness. Bind the devil and cast him out. And for self, die daily to self. Crucify the old nature and allow the new man in Christ to reign and live. Lord, may your love flow through us. Help us to serve others. Grab a towel. Wash the feet of those who need it, whatever form that may take. Not betray you, certainly, but continue to love our neighbor as ourself and not deny you. A new commandment you've given to us, Lord, to love one another. Enable us to do it by your example and by your indwelling presence. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.